sit for a little bit before we start. That's fine. Good morning, everyone. A very warm welcome to St. Margaret's Church this morning, to our service of said Holy Communion. It's lovely to see you all. A couple of notices. They're all on our website. We're doing some support for the Easter team, collecting food. So Sue Gilbert is collecting food on behalf of everyone, and she'll come around and collect it for you if you're not able to deliver it yourself. We're also, Sue Edgson is coordinating telephone befriending, so there are ways that you can get involved with and help out. So please look at the website. We are updating our parish electoral roll. So if you've been coming for sort of 6 months or so, then you can join the electoral roll. I think it's a rerun of the electoral roll. So I think everyone needs to put in their forms to sign up to it. We're also looking for deanery synod representatives to attend deanery synod in the future. So have a word with myself or Chris if you want to find out a little bit more. Inez has also been. Are you still on the synod, Inez?
I'm not sure, but okay. I'm happy to be.
Okay, lovely, thank you. Lastly, before we start, I just wanted to say a little bit about communion, because everyone will be staying where they are during communion. But during communion, we'll start off from this side. So from the front here, people will come up and we'll work down the back. Sue and Miranda will be available to help. But basically it's a one-way system, so For you coming up first, obviously you can come straight back to there, that's fine. But if as we move back, if we do a one-way system, if you come up and then go around and come back to your seat, so we're having a one-way system. We'll go down here, down the middle, and then from the back. Okay, brilliant.
First, I'm going to publish the banns of marriage, so you can keep sitting down for that. I publish the banns of marriage between Landon James Cerf and Annabel Louise Tyson, both of the parish of South Crawley. This is the second time of asking. If any of you know any reason why in law why they may not marry each other, you are to declare it. So let us pray for this couple as they prepare for their wedding under more than normal peculiar circumstances. And may their preparations go smoothly and their love for each other grow even more, so that the day of their marriage may be the first day of the rest of their happy lives together. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So we meet in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
We pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. Second is this: Love your neighbour as yourself. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins to be our advocate in heaven and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins. Confirm and strengthen us in all goodness and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father, receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. Let your merciful ears, O Lord, be open to the prayers of your humble servants, and that they may obtain their petitions, make them to ask such things as shall please you. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. So please will you sit for the readings.
The first reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 56. Verse 1 and verses 6 to 8. The covenant extended to all who obey. Thus says the Lord, maintain justice and do what is right. For soon my salvation will come and my deliverance be revealed. And the foreigners who join themselves to the Lord to minister to him, to love the name of the Lord and to be his servants, all who keep the Sabbath and do not profane it, and hold fast my covenant, these I will bring to my holy mountain, and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices will be accepted on my altar, for my house shall be called a house of prayer for all peoples. Thus says the Lord God, who gathers the outcasts of Israel, I will gather others to them, besides those already gathered. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. I ask then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but now have received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient, in order that by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience, so so that he may be merciful to all. This is the word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew.
Glory to you, our Lord.
Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, "Do you know that the Pharisees took offence when they heard what you said?" He answered, "Every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit." But Peter said to him, "Explain this parable to us." Then he said, "Are you also still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart, and this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defiles a person. But to eat with unwashed hands does not defile." Jesus went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. A Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, "Have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon." But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, "Send her away, for she keeps shouting after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." He answered, "It is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." And her daughter was healed instantly. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May I speak in the name of God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. As I was preparing this sermon, our eldest son sent us photos of the foundations of their new home. These are no ordinary photos. They tell a story. Philip, his wife and 12-year-old boy, live in a two-bedroom flat in Hartford. 4 years ago, they found an overgrown plot of land nearby and were able to purchase it, subject to obtaining planning permission. Philip began drawing up plans for their new home. The land lies in a conservation area, and the local council kept throwing up obstacles, but Philip refused to give up hope. Finally, after 3 rejected applications, numerous redesigns, and much prayer, planning permission was granted on appeal, and work began, hence the photos. Philip puts it all down to his stubbornness. And those of you who know Chris and me well may like to consider which of his parents he gets this from. But I like to think of it as persistence. The perfect illustration of the second part of this morning's gospel, the story of the Canaanite woman and her daughter.
Jesus, Matthew tells us, withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. These towns were in Gentile territory, places no Jew would normally visit. Here, Jesus and his disciples could enjoy temporary respite from the hostility of the Pharisees and from the crowds who constantly followed them. But Jesus' reputation as a healer must have spilled across the border, and this one woman is desperate for help. There's much about her to admire. She's unselfish. Her request isn't for herself, but for her daughter, whom she obviously loves greatly. She has faith, faith which causes her to move from addressing Jesus by the earthly title, Son of David, to the divine title, Lord. In the space of a few sentences, her plea to a great man becomes a prayer to the living God as she gets down on her knees and worships. In contrast to the formal prayers of the Pharisees, her prayer is not part of a ritual, but the outpouring of passion. She also has a sense of humour, evident in the way she banters with Jesus. And finally, she's persistent. Despite being aware of who she's talking to, she refuses to take no for an answer. One of the difficulties with this story of the Canaanite woman is that we can't hear Jesus' tone when he answers that it isn't fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. Although the term dogs was used by Jews as an insult to Gentiles, the most accurate translation of Jesus' words is puppies, young household pets who would have been fed scraps from the table, not feral dogs who roam the streets. There might even be a hint of affection and respect in Jesus' voice as he invites the woman's bold response. Yes, Lord, even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. As the preacher in this morning's Sunday worship on Radio 4 pointed out, this woman has been immortalised in the words of Thomas Cranmer's Prayer of Humble Access, the one we use during Lent and Advent before we receive the bread and wine of Holy Communion. Lord, I am not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs from under your table. The woman's persistence paid off in more ways than one. But in addition to persistence, you may have spotted another theme running through this morning's readings. No one is excluded from the kingdom of heaven. Isaiah prophesies that it's not only Jews who will be welcome on God's holy mountain and in his house of prayer. And St. Paul's message is similar. He's proud of being both a Jew and a Roman citizen. Writing to the newly established church in Rome, Paul explains that because Gentiles are finding faith, it certainly doesn't follow that God has rejected the Jews. God doesn't take away the gifts he gives, even when they're seemingly rejected by their recipients. Instead, he offers his gifts more widely. God embraces everyone who puts their trust in him. All the faithful will receive his mercy. And God's mercy is about much more than just forgiveness. It's justice, harmony, and the restoration of relationship. My first two readings, then, were relatively straightforward. But as often happens, the gospel needs more unpacking. At first hearing, the two parts of today's reading from Matthew can seem unrelated. Yet the story of the Canaanite woman follows naturally from a confrontation between Jesus and a group of Pharisees. These Pharisees have criticized Jesus' followers over their failure to keep the Jewish hygiene laws. Jesus responds by teaching them and the crowds following him that what makes people unclean is not what they put into their mouths, they do so, but what comes out of their mouths, that is, what's in their hearts. As we've seen, what was in the heart of the Canaanite woman poured out of her mouth when she encountered Jesus. In these days when we're constantly urged to wash our hands, Jesus' advice might seem a little surprising. In our current situation, to eat with unwashed hands would be unwise, to say the least. But Jesus' point is about ritual washing, following rules which have no part in true religion. Pleasing God is not a matter of obeying rules, but of the heart, of building a relationship with him. Jesus' lesson can be a hard one. It's so much easier to abstain from certain foods and wash your hands in a certain way than it is to follow him, to love the unlovely and unlovable, to help the needy at the cost of one's own time and money, comfort and pleasure. In a similar way, coming to church or watching this service online or joining the PCC or contributing to the planned giving scheme are all good things in themselves, but they're not true religion. True religion is about our relationship with God and with our neighbour. What matters to God is not how we act, but why we act. Not what we actually do, but what we wish in our hearts to do. Theologian Thomas Aquinas sums this up. Man sees the deed, but God sees the intention. Several groups of people have much to learn from today's gospel. The Pharisees think God's gifts are just for them. The Canaanite woman knows they're for everyone. The disciples think they are the faithful ones. But not long ago, out on the lake, Jesus accused Peter of having little faith. Now he praises this woman for her great faith. And what about us? What can we learn? Hopefully, firstly, that no one is unworthy of God's grace, love, and mercy. Secondly, that God wants us to be persistent, to ask him for the gifts we need to fulfill our dreams. So during the coming week, let's take a moment to think. What do you really want God to do for you in your life? Then ask him. Amen.
Please, will you stand?
Do you believe and trust in God the Father who made all things?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Son Jesus Christ who redeemed the world?
We believe and trust in him.
Do you believe and trust in his Holy Spirit who gives life to the people of God?
We believe and trust in him.
This is the faith of the Church.
This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen. We sit or kneel as we pray to the Father, for the Church, the world, and all human beings.
Blessed are you, Lord our God, for you have created us out of love and for your love. Even when in our sin and foolishness we go and leave you, you are there to seek us Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Loving God, may your church throughout the world show your love for all peoples and nations. Bless all who seek to heal divisions and to do away with prejudice. Lord of life and love, hear us and help us. Loving God, we ask forgiveness for the sin of arrogance that divides us and creates barriers between nations and peoples. We pray with love for all minority groups, for those who are judged by their race, colour or history. We remember all who are refugees, homeless or outcasts of society, and we particularly remember the people of Beirut suffering from the tragic explosion there. At this time, Lord, as we recall the ending of the Second World War, we remember all who lost their lives in that conflict and in subsequent wars. We give thanks for all peacemakers and pray that we may learn the lessons from history. We ask your blessing upon all who work to bring a new unity and understanding between divided peoples. Lord of life and love, loving God, we thank you for our homes and for all who have accepted us in love and generosity. We ask your blessing upon our homes and the community in which we live. We pray particularly for those who have recently received their A-level marks and particularly those who feel disappointed. We pray for all who are suffering from broken relationships and all who feel estranged from the world around them. Lord of life and love,
hear us and help us.
Loving God, we offer you our gratitude to all emergency workers as we remember the tragedy of the Scottish Rail disaster and the floods and storms that have caused so much damage in the recent weather events. We remember those who lost their lives or were injured. We pray for all on holiday and abroad and those suffering or affected by the surge in the coronavirus and the impact it's having on people's lives. Lord of life and love,
hear us and help us.
Loving God, we give thanks for our health and well-being. We ask your blessing on all who are ill at home or in hospital. We pray particularly for the patients of Langley Green Hospital, for Christine, William McKenna, Sheena Cook, Anne Utting, Rose Scarborough, Myra Tyson, Arthur and Doris Paddington, Richard Whitehouse, Karen Kelso, John Hartridge, and Bunty Lyons. We remember today also all those who suffer from autism and schizophrenia and all who are mentally ill. We ask your blessing upon all who are separated from loved ones through illness and all who feel rejected. Lord of life and love,
hear us and help us.
Loving God, in your redeeming love, you accept us and welcome us. We ask you to give joy and peace to all our loved ones departed this life. And we remember particularly the recently departed Thomas Bennett and those whose years mine falls at this time, Mark Peters, Cyril Wakeling, Frederick Johnston, Albert Green, Terence Fisher, Charles Misson, and Steve Doe. May they know the fullness of salvation. To you and to your love we commit the whole world, our loved ones and ourselves. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Please, will you stand? Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name, we share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
So let us offer one another a sign of peace with a big smile. Heavenly Father, accept these prayers left this past week on the fishing net. We pray that you will meet these people at their point of need. Amen. Amen. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendour and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you. And of your own did you give me. Wise and gracious God, you spread a table before us. Nourish your people with the word of life and the bread of heaven. Amen. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, Lord God, our light and our salvation. To you be glory and praise forever. From the beginning, you have created all things, and all your works echo the silent music of your praise. In the fullness of time, you made us in your image, the crown of all creation. You give us breath and speech, that with angels and archangels and all the powers of heaven, we may find a voice to sing your praise. Holy,
holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
How wonderful the work of your hands, O Lord. As a mother tenderly gathers her children, you embraced a people as your own. When they turned away and rebelled, your love remained steadfast. From them you raised up Jesus our Saviour, born of Mary, to be the living bread in whom all our hungers are satisfied. He offered his life for sinners, and with a love stronger than death, he opened wide his arms on the cross. On the night before he died, he came to supper with his friends, and taking bread, he gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me." Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Dying, you destroyed our death.
Rising, you restored our life. Lord Jesus, come in glory.
Father, we plead with confidence his sacrifice made once for all upon the cross. We remember his dying and rising in glory, and we rejoice that he intercedes for us at your right hand. Pour out your Holy Spirit as we bring before you these gifts of your creation. May they be for us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy things in your presence, form us in the likeness of Christ and build us into a living temple to your glory. Remember, Lord, your church in every land. Reveal her unity, guard her faith, and preserve her in peace. Bring us at the last with St. Margaret and all the saints to the vision of that eternal splendour for which you have created us, through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, with all who stand before you in earth and heaven, we worship you, Father Almighty, in songs of everlasting praise. Blessing and honour and glory and power be yours forever and ever. Amen. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread. Share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share.
come, not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come, not because any goodness of your own gives you any right to come, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loves you and gave himself for you.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world, grant us peace.
The body of Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Blood of Christ.
Amen.
Thank you. Has anyone got the Aubrey key, please? Sorry? We've got more people than before, which is lovely. Please pardon my delay. Let us pray. God of our pilgrimage, you have willed that the gate of mercy should stand open for those who trust in you. Look upon us with your favour, that we who follow the path of your will may never wander from the way of life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen.
We go into the world to walk in God's light, to rejoice in God's love, and to reflect God's glory. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.